Hey everybody, Matt Lewis here. We're doing something a little bit different today. If you're listening to this on the audio podcast, we are also simulcasting this on video. You can find it on YouTube. So check that out. Hopefully this is something that we're going to be doing a lot more of in the future. And I want to thank the Leadership Institute. We're taping here today at the Leadership Institute in Arlington, Virginia. It is a great organization. I worked at LI for 4 years. I interned there. And in fact, I'm teaching a class called How to Be a Pundit coming up in May here at the Leadership Institute. It's basically everything that I've learned along the way about how to be a columnist, how to be a TV commentator, you name it. We're going to talk about it, and I will teach you what I know at that class. So please check it out. And if you're interested in becoming a better political candidate, becoming a better communicator, learning how to go on television, any of that stuff, I recommend the Leadership Institute. Check it out, leadershipinstitute.org. I also want to make a quick plug for this awesome Matt Lewis and the Mob t-shirt. You can get it on patreon.com/Matt Lewis. And nothing says 2018 retro more than a Matt Lewis and the Mob t-shirt. And special thanks to Hard Hits Custom Apparel, who made these awesome shirts. Thank you for that. All right. We're blessed to be joined by a terrific guest today. Our first of these video interviews, Kristin Soltis Anderson. You are a founding partner at Echelon Insights, a polling firm. You are the author of The Selfie Vote and the co-host of The Pollsters Podcast, which is a very popular podcast. Kristin Soltis Anderson, welcome to the news.
Thank you for having me.
I wanted to start off by talking about what is shaping up right now. As we tape this, I guess Bernie Sanders has gotten in the 2020 Democratic primary. The field is still forming, but what are you seeing in terms of being a pollster that might help us figure out which way this is going to shake out?
So I think when you're thinking about the 2020 Democratic primary electorate, it's informative to first think about the Republican electorate in 2016, where you have a group of voters whose number one goal is for the other side to lose, right? That you had a lot of Republican voters who just very much so did not want Hillary Clinton to be president. And so whoever was going to help them achieve that goal, that was most important for them. Whether it was Donald Trump or Jeb Bush, that was what they sorted out in the primary. And we wound up with Donald Trump as president. So for Democrats in 2020, you know, there's sometimes this tension between electability and who sort of holds my values, right? There may be a candidate who I love them on all of the issues, but maybe realistically I know they can't win or they're too far outside the mainstream or what have you, but I really love them. And so when you think about that dynamic, the conventional wisdom is that your more moderate voter is going to be more interested in electability. Maybe they're less passionate about certain principles. They just kind of want their team to win. They're wearing the team jersey. They like winning. Where the true progressives or the true conservatives, they want someone who's going to, you know, be true principled, and they're going to check the box on all these issues, and they'll pass the litmus test. And in polling of the Democratic primary electorate for 2020, that dynamic is inverted. You actually have the moderates who are much more likely to say, I want someone who agrees with me on the issues. I don't want someone who's too far afield from what I believe. And you have the progressives who are more willing to say, I just want someone who will beat Donald Trump. Just right. Give me whoever will beat Donald Trump.
Like this is the reverse partisanship, or what's
negative
the term?
Partisanship.
Negative partisanship.
Yeah, that the number one policy goal for a lot of progressives is Donald Trump not being president. That's like job one. And so for them, you know, in a way, that creates a dynamic where someone like an Amy Klobuchar, you know, there's all this debate, well, is she too moderate? Is she going to win over the progressives to who want to have someone like really tug at their heartstrings and talk about socialism and what have you? And, you know, she did her town hall where she said, no, I don't believe in free college for all. I mean, certain things that are on the progressive wish list, she's openly said that's not what she's about. But if she can prove that she's someone who is best equipped to defeat Donald Trump, she could win over those moderates who sort of share her sensibilities, who may like her record as a prosecutor or enjoy those Midwestern values, that Minnesota nice vibe. But at the same time, if she demonstrates she could be the one to beat Donald Trump, that may be enough for the progressives in the party.
If, though, because I'm wondering if there might be like a semantics issue here or something, right? Because if you had asked me, now granted I'm inside the Beltway, inside the bubble, but if you had asked me who's the most electable candidate, I wouldn't have thought Donald Trump. I would have thought maybe like a Marco Rubio is the most. So if I valued electability over anything, I would have maybe said Rubio. We don't know. Rubio might have actually gone on to win for all we know, but Trump ended up being the guy who won. And I don't think you would have, I don't think I would have said, If you care about winning, if you care about beating Hillary. But it may be that the Republican electorate, they wanted a fighter, which makes me wonder about the Democrats. When they say they want someone who is the most electable, we're thinking, okay, well, maybe that's Klobuchar. That makes sense. But maybe they're thinking, no, it's...
And I think you're right on that. And that's why I think thinking about that question through the lens of the 2016 Republican primary electorate is important. That we may have assumed electability meant... Jeb! Exclamation point. He can appeal to a broader swath of people. Where Republican voters were saying, no, you guys keep nominating these establishment people and they're not winning. So your definition of electability is not my definition of electability anymore. And so there is a chance that is why you now have progressives saying, I believe that beating Donald Trump is job number one. It could mean that they're willing to accept a more moderate nominee if that person proves that they can fight or proves they have what it takes to defeat Donald Trump. But it also may mean that they're going, look, we nominated Hillary Clinton, and she wasn't someone that really got the progressive grassroots excited. And just like Republicans had a Donald Trump who got the grassroots excited on the right, we need that for the left. We need someone who's going to fire us up. So I think you're completely right that the way we think of electability sometimes tends to be around moderateness. And that's probably not the right way to think about it, that it could be much more about temperament and ability to communicate well and a sense that you can have a broader message.
Right.
But I do think that ideological divide does sort of cut against what you would normally expect, that it's the moderates who are more likely to say, I want someone who agrees with me on issues, and it's progressives who are more likely to say, I want someone who's electable.
Absolutely. Well, my take on electability would be the biggest problem facing Democrats is not winning the popular vote, it's winning the Electoral College, and therefore who can win that. And I think probably the industrial Midwest is the best way to do that, to take Ohio or Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan. And then the question is, who's best positioned to do that? I mean, do you buy that calculus?
Yeah, I think in order for Democrats to win, I mean, there is a way you can, and I think it's hard to get the math there without flipping a Pennsylvania back, without flipping Michigan back. A state like Ohio voted about the same way as Texas in the 2016 election, so the odds that Democrats are just going to like turn Ohio blue again, I am no longer in the business of saying anything is impossible in politics, but when Ohio is voting the same way as Texas, you kind of start to take that one a little bit off the board. But without flipping something like a Pennsylvania or a Michigan, the math is really hard. And if you're not flipping a Pennsylvania and a Michigan, are you really flipping a Florida, which in the midst of a blue wave election made Ron DeSantis governor? I mean, how much is Florida really on the table? They still kind of like Donald Trump down there.
I think there's a conventional wisdom almost emerging that Donald Trump can't win and that he's a dead man walking.
I think that's insane.
I do too. I think that it's at least 50-50. I mean, number one, we have a pattern right now of the last, three presidents or more electing two-term presidents. I mean, Jimmy Carter or George H.W. Bush was the last one-term president. So,
you could argue that without the intervening force of Ross Perot, he might have even won. I mean, well, there's considerable debate about that in political science circles. But anyhow.
Well, we don't want to open that up. I don't need emails from Steve Kornacki on that. Anyway, I guess the point is that that Donald Trump very well could go on to win re-election, especially if Democrats nominate a bad candidate and continue to blow it. Look, we're early on in this cycle, but it does seem to me that Democrats have not only moved more to the left, now I know America in general has moved to the left, but I think the Democrats are outpacing them right now, maybe with the exception of Amy Klobuchar, who's in the race. But there are also just a series of gaffes and scandals. Even Amy Klobuchar has this mini scandal that has emerged about her being kind of a mean boss. Are we making too much out of this, or do you think that that might be something that is not a good omen going forward?
Well, I think for the specific Klobuchar story or for the movement of the Democratic Party? So for the specific Klobuchar story, it depends on if there are more shoes to drop, I think. I think the details you have so far are not flattering, but no candidate is going to be perfect, and I think there are, every candidate's going to have something crop up. I don't know that that is a total deal breaker, but that assumes that the story is sort of done, and
right.
We know everything there is to know, and there is a long way to go.
What if there are audio tapes that come out, or voicemails, or memos, or anything like that? My theory is on Joe Biden, I have to say, who's not in the race yet. I don't know if he's going to get in the race, but I think the thing about Donald Trump was that everything about him was baked in the cake. So if he said something stupid or controversial, people were like, well, that's Trump being Trump. And I think that Joe Biden has that as well. He's already committed so many gaffes and controversies. I don't think Biden is as susceptible to negative information knocking him down as the rest of the Democratic field. I mean, do you buy that?
I think that's probably right. I think it's also a factor of him just having much higher name ID and a stronger brand presence in people's mind, which is similar to what you said about Trump, that most voters are just getting to know who Amy Klobuchar is. They may be just getting to know who Cory Booker or Kamala Harris are. Maybe they've seen them on TV before, they've seen little clips, but they're really beginning to learn much more about these people, whereas Joe Biden was running for president when I was in preschool. So Joe Biden's been around. People know who he is. He was vice president for 8 years, and he has a very strong, he's a very pre-aware property in the world of politics. So I think when it comes to someone like Joe Biden, his bigger problem is going to be less the things that he could say on the trail moving forward and more how do the things that he believed in the past line up with the current Democratic Party. Positions on things like things that he may have said or done during the Anita Hill testimony, thing, the crime bill, et cetera. There are some moments in Joe Biden, when you have a political history that goes back into the, decades gone by, with the speed of change, especially in the Democratic Party, of what is or is not acceptable or popular, things have changed a lot. The Democratic Party is very different than the Democratic Party of the 80s. And to what extent can you be forgiven, or can you make the case that you have evolved? He may be able to. Remember, he was the one that sort of kicked off Barack Obama's evolution on gay marriage.
Right.
He sort of like let the cat out of the bag, like, oh, don't worry, he's gonna have a, I believe he thinks differently on this issue.
Yeah.
So evolution is totally possible, even on hot button controversial issues. But can he do it, or is the Democratic Party going, look, it is time to turn the page?
I think
it's his past more than his future, his potential future gaffes that would be the bigger problem.
Yeah, and I think that, but I think this speaks to what we were opened up with, is the question is how do Democrats define electability? I mean, if you define electability as the ability to win working class whites in Pennsylvania, then maybe Joe Biden is your man, and you can overlook sins of the past and all that. But if you define electability as someone who is going to who checks all the boxes, who's intersectional, well, that's certainly not Joe Biden.
Well, bear in mind, I mean, the Democratic strategy writ large in the midterms did define, I think, electability as who fits the place where they are running. So when Republicans had kind of the Tea Party revolution in 2010, the ranks of new members were not filled generally with like lots of moderates coming. I mean, it was a lot of, they had found some real real conservatives who were winning even in districts that you might not think could, maybe they were more conservative than the district, but they had the energy behind them. What Democrats, I think, did pretty well this time around is you had people who were the right fit for that district who are able to pull it off. Now, there's been so much focus on the Rashida Tlaibs and the Alexandria Ocasio-Cortezes and such, and the really sort of far-left, hot-button members. But a lot of Democratic freshmen are people you've never heard of who were more moderate than what you might think of the National Democratic Party's
direction.
The problem,
though, in 2020, you pick one nominee, and so you don't have the luxury of saying, we've got a moderate in Pennsylvania who's going to run for president in Pennsylvania who likes guns, and then we've got AOC in Queens or Brooklyn.
Sure, but in 2010, remember, there was a big effort, like, we're going to primary people. I mean, that sense of you need to be ideologically pure was kind of already in the air, whereas on the Democratic side, it's sort of just beginning to kick up, this idea of, like, we're going to have lots of primaries and things. So it may reach a fever pitch as we're getting toward, like, the Democratic convention, and it could be a factor there. But so far, it has been less of a factor than I think it was during the Republican Party's, you know, Tea Party moment and sort of rise through the aughts.
Well, speaking of primaries, there is talk that President Donald Trump could be primaried. This is what you hear from Bill Kristol and others. And on one hand, it seems absurd. On the other hand, who knows? The world, crazy things happen. Wouldn't have thought Donald Trump was going to be president 5 years ago. So crazy things happen and things change. Where are you at on this question?
I think the only person who has the power to make Donald Trump not the Republican nominee in 2020 is Donald Trump. If he decides that he thinks he might not win, he decides he's bored with it, he doesn't like the job anymore, he wants to walk away a winner. Hey, I did everything I promised in one term. I don't even need a second. Over to you, Mikey. You know, I mean, there's a chance that he decides he just doesn't want to run again. Maybe. I'm not going to psychoanalyze him. But the reason I say it's only to him is that I don't think that the Republican electorate is that hungry for a primary fight. I think they want to continue. They might like Trump to tweet less. They don't love everything that he's doing. But for the most part, you have a lot of Republican voters who may have held their nose and voted for him in 2016, who have kind of warmed up to some of the things that he has done, have shifted their positions on issues like trade or Russia to conform to what the Trump moment has provided.
And this is, we should talk about this for a second. This is the follow the leader syndrome phenomenon. And I don't think people realize this, how much the American public reverse engineers their political views based on the politicians that they like.
So thinking about primary politics, for instance, just today, Ariel Edwards-Levy, who writes about polling for HuffPo, she had like a big thread on Twitter about how we sometimes forget that when you ask people in primaries, what attributes do you want out of a candidate? They are not choosing attributes and then choosing a candidate they like, that they reverse engineer that. So for instance, you can watch shifts in parties' beliefs about should we have a president who is of a certain age. Back in 2008, Republicans were quite fine with an older president, where Democrats thought, no, we don't want an older president.
Right.
And then you fast forward to 2016 and the Democratic primary, and suddenly Hillary Clinton voters are fine with an older president. They think that's okay.
Evangelicals did this with the question of, like, does a president's personal life and background or values matter? And Republicans and evangelicals used to say, yes.
We come to conclusions about people based on things that are hard for us to consciously untangle, and then we reverse engineer our policy positions and which attributes do we like and not like to kind of fit that. And there's tons of evidence to back that up. And you're seeing things like that happen with already with something like the National Emergency Declaration.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you looked at the polling a week or two ago on do Republicans think it would be a good idea, well, one, who supports the wall? Republicans used to be kind of supportive of the wall, but in the last year or two have dramatically increased their support for the wall. Meanwhile, Democrats have gone the opposite way.
Yeah.
They used to be kind of open to the idea of some kind of barrier, fencing, and now suddenly, no, absolutely no, we don't want any of that. So views on something like the wall suddenly became very closely aligned to your views on Trump. So same thing's kind of happening with the National Emergency Declaration. You had a lot of Republicans, about a third, I would say, of Republicans who said, I don't think a national emergency is the right way to go about the wall. I mean, you had a small portion of that that just didn't want the wall already. But when you said, well, should you use a national emergency to get there? Support wound up falling to closer to around 60%. Still a majority, but pretty low, kind of, if you think about how much Republicans tend to support everything else President Trump does. But the polling that I have seen since he took the action to say, we're doing this, we're declaring a national emergency, those numbers have gone up back closer to 85%,
wow,
which is around where his job approval is with Republicans.
Which is exactly the opposite of what the Tea Party position, Republican position, would have been in 2010 or 2014.
Exactly.
When Obama, I think, was engaged.
He's getting governed by pen and phone,
right,
and people freaked out. And
he's an emperor. He's a Caesar.
Yeah. Well, the last person who cares about Article 1, like, turn off the lights on the way out. Because, the principles, and I have been heartened to see the number of lawmakers who have sort of stood up for this, like, look, I want to support the president, but we need to make sure that the laws are not giving the president too much power. This is wrong, Congress, you know, like the Mike Lee, like, hey, this isn't right. I have been heartened to see the number of even very conservative senators from states where Trump is very well loved sort of pushing back on this and saying I'm not crazy about it. But when push comes to shove, I'm unsure what the vote will finally look like, if there is any kind of vote, because the Republican Party now, in just the last couple of days, the electorate has come around to this and said, well, Trump wants to do it, so I kind of like it.
Yeah.
And that is
something,
just the world of politics we live in.
Something you said a minute ago, which I think is worth talking about a little bit, is how Trump has this ability to, it's like the opposite of persuasion. So, like, Democrats are less interested, less supportive of a wall today than they used to be. And so Donald Trump supporting something actually turns off a lot of the country that used to be for it. What are we to make of that? How problematic is that? What are the ramifications?
Well, this is, I think, one of the things that's going to be a big challenge for him in a potential reelection. So while I agree with you that we tend to reelect presidents, I think the idea that he's toast is insane. I think he has a fairly good chance of being reelected. But one of the bigger problems is that he has a base that is very loyal to him, but it has struggled consistently to get beyond that base, to get folks who are independents and maybe not conservative independents to go, you know what? He's doing a good job. The one area where he gets high marks, even from people who are not in his base, is the economy. It's, you know, the economic boom of the last year or two has been undeniable. People are really kind of feeling it, and they're kind of giving the president credit for it. But otherwise, he does not have the ability to just go to an independent voter and say, hey, I am doing this thing, come along with me, and they give him the benefit of the doubt. It's quite the opposite. And so when he decides he supports something, Republican support will go from 60 to 85%. But support everywhere else will drop. And you can't put together a national coalition with just a base of a loyal third of the country. You need to go beyond that. In the midterms, Republicans weren't able to get far enough beyond that, and that's why they suffered big losses. With Trump's name at the top of the ticket, it's unclear. You know, does he suddenly turn out a ton of Republican voters who sat home in the midterms? I don't think so. Republicans turned out in the midterms. Turnout was not the reason why Republicans lost in the midterms. So I think he's got to get beyond. He loves talking to his base because he loves the applause, he loves the affirmation, but he's got to get beyond that if he wants to really make sure he can shore up those blue wall states.
You're the author of the Selfie book, and you've talked a lot, written a lot about millennials. And when we talk about the future and Donald Trump getting beyond his base, you've got some bad news based on the surveys. I know you've talked a lot about
this. I've had bad news for a decade. This is what I do.
you've talked a lot about this, over the years and even recently. But I know that there's a new finding that something like 40% of Republicans under 40 who voted for Mitt Romney did not vote for Donald Trump. That seems to be, as a lot of Trump voters age and eventually leave us, that may obviously put the Republican Party in a demographic time bomb.
Yeah, so this is a new number. This 40% figure just came out last week. And I still need to dig into it more, in part because one of the things they're asserting is not that 40% of Romney voters under 40 voted for Hillary Clinton or voted for Jill Stein. They're also saying many of them sat home.
Yeah.
And this is a really wonky political data nerd thing, but voter files are the way that you would track that. Did someone vote one time? Did they vote again? And if I move from state A to state B, sometimes my vote history doesn't come with me. And so all of which is to say, I want to dig into that number a little bit more before I consider it gospel, but I do think that the finding itself comports with a lot of other stuff that I've seen, which is that younger voters have been trending away from the GOP since about 2006.
So this predates Trump.
This predates Trump. It predates Obama. That George W. Bush lost young voters, but only by about a 10-point margin in his reelection in 2004. At this point, you already had the Iraq War, which was an issue and not necessarily on the totally right track. But that was sort of the last time Republicans were really competitive with young voters in a major election. The 2006 midterms, voters in that 18 to 29-year-old block break away from the GOP by a 22-point margin. When I looked back at the history of exit polls.
And this is before the Great Recession, too.
Before the Great Recession, before Barack Obama.
So this is Katrina. This is the Iraq War turning south.
This is Katrina and the Iraq War.
Okay.
It's Katrina, it's the Iraq War, and the country was just general. I mean, George W. Bush's job approval at that time was below where Donald Trump's is now. but that was sort of the first rupture. And if you look at exit polling going back decades, and you look at different age groups and how they broke, I could not find evidence of any age group breaking so dramatically for one party over the other. Like, I couldn't find a generation gap quite that large in any midterm up till that point. Which is why in 2009 I wrote my master's thesis on this and began kind of digging into this topic and every new data point made me more terrified for the future for the GOP and of conservatism, which are separate items but related. These trends have just continued. You had Republicans lose young voters by a 2-to-1 margin in the 2008 election. Young voters were not a huge factor in the 2010 midterms. In 2012, Mitt Romney had repaired a little bit of the damage, made some gains, but not enough, was still losing young voters by about a 20-point margin. And then you get to Donald Trump, and he makes no improvement over Mitt Romney. He only wins, I think it was something like 36% of young voters. Now, Hillary Clinton declined from Obama. You had a lot more young voters break for third parties. But still, I mean, Republicans now at this point had a pattern of elections where they'd lost young people. And then you get to the last midterm, and now it's not just young voters, it's voters in their 30s. Voters in their 30s broke for Democrats by a 22-point margin. Those very same voters that were 18 to 29-year-olds in the 2006 midterms. They got older, but they didn't get more conservative.
Well, that's always the hope. The hope is immigrants come to America, become middle class, turn into Republicans. Yeah, it was a Churchill quote. Any young man who's not a liberal.
He never actually said it, by the way.
It's apocryphal.
I have looked into this in depth.
Well, most of the quotes.
Because I hear it so often. People say, oh, Kristen, you're wrong. Churchill, he said.
I'm willing to agree. So it must have been George Orwell who said, or Abraham Lincoln. Okay, you know the cliche, right?
Yeah.
That people, as they get older, you have, you get married, it's a civil life. You have kids, they go to schools, you pay taxes, you get a mortgage. It's a civilizing thing. We become more bourgeois.
Baby boomers think that is the universal truth because it was true for them. So baby boomers, you know, back in started off kind of
the hippies in the 60s.
You have Watergate, Vietnam, like they're progressive, and then all of a sudden, then you get Reagan, and they become more conservative as they get older, and suddenly those views kind of change. And they sort of assume that for every generation, it works the same way. And there's a fascinating study that the folks at the New York Times Upshot blog did a few years ago, where they looked at political partisanship by birth year. And so you could say, oh, I was born in 1958.
Yeah.
Like, what does my cohort's political leanings look like over the course of their lifetime? And it shows that for those baby boomers, you know, they start off progressive and then they move up the chart to be more conservative. Gen Xers kind of start off in the middle and like their line doesn't move a ton. For millennials, they start off very progressive and they stay there. They stay there as they get older. As they enter their 30s, as they start having kids, as they start buying homes, they're not becoming more conservative. And now, again, the oldest millennials are in their late 30s. They're not, you know, kids living in mom and dad's basement
anymore. So what happens
in
20 or 30 years when the average Fox News viewer is dead and Republicans have to compete? One question I have is, obviously, Donald Trump didn't start this problem. Mm-hmm. He certainly hasn't fixed this problem. Has he complicated this problem?
Yes.
Has he made it worse?
Yes, in part because there were two ways that the Trump presidency could have gone, one of which I actually think could have helped Republicans with younger voters, and one way which would have further entrenched the pre-existing problems. So the thing he could have done that I think could have helped Republicans with younger voters is he could have been a sort of non-ideological disruptor. He could have come in and said, look, I just want to make government work better. I don't feel chained to the way things have been done. Just because a bureaucracy has existed for decades and has done X, Y, and Z doesn't mean it has to keep doing that. Let's think about things in a radical new way.
Plus, he's not like locked into the Mike Pence social conservative world. I mean, he's easily like pro-gay marriage and things like that.
If you had told me that someone was going to stand up at the Republican convention in 2016 who was really savvy at social media and they were going to be our nominee and they were going to do things like applaud that the GOP was going to stand for LGBTQ rights, I would have been like, who do we nominate? Huh. Did they read my book?
And
Interesting. Not only
who do we nominate, but now all of a sudden it's going to get better with young people, with millennials. And
it was Donald Trump. Yeah. He was the social media, you know, hey, we're going to fight for LG. I mean, and that has not always necessarily been the reality of his presidency. But, you know, there was this opportunity at the beginning where I thought, huh, you know, he could go this way and it could be interesting. But instead, kind of the doubling down on rhetoric that becomes racially divisive. I mean, racial tensions in America have become further inflamed. The pursuit of the immigration issue and the trade issue, I think, have spoken more to kind of a populist sentiment. And frankly, just make America great again is kind of a backwards-looking sentiment in a way.
Right.
It's saying
it's a
there's something
to the past, not a bridge to the future.
That there are things that we've lost that we need to reclaim, and most young people do not look back on the past with a great sense of fondness. I mean, to the extent that maybe 90s nostalgia is in vogue with like Captain Marvel.
But he's thinking 1950s.
I don't think he's like looking for like the halcyon days of like the Clinton administration, right? That's not. So I think that in pursuing that strategy, I mean, you find that Trump's approval rating among young people is 30%. I mean, that's terrible. And it is forming young people's view of what it means to be Republican and conservative in a way that is distressing to me, who thinks that's not what I think of as conservatism, but it's also just not something that is lining up with or appealing to their worldview greatly.
Here's where I think it's an interesting question, okay? So there's a theory that, like, if your baseball team wins the World Series when you're 9 years old, like the Orioles did when I was 9 years old, you will be a fan of that team for the rest of your life. And so Grover Norquist has this theory that, like, whoever's president when you're 18, you'll be locked into that the first time you vote. And so if Reagan was president when you turned 18, you have a much higher propensity to be a Republican or a conservative for the rest of your life. It's a theory, at least. I think the counterargument to this is that things move faster, right? So after Herbert Hoover, when FDR came in, people got locked into being a Democrat. I'm an FDR New Deal Democrat. And the Democrats dominated for like 40 years. I don't know that that happens anymore. We live in a world now where people don't stay at a job for more than a couple of years. They don't necessarily stay married. They don't belong to, it used to be people join these institutions, right? I go to the Elks Club, and I've been married for 50 years, and I worked at this company for 40 years. And so I'm wondering if the fears that we have that the Republican Party is going to be permanently branded Trump's party actually could just maybe the party reinvents itself. And look, Reagan won 6 years after Watergate, so maybe let's ride out the Trump thing. Let's get our judges. Let's get our tax cuts. Take it as far as we can go. Then we throw him under the bus and we get on the Ben Sasse bandwagon or the Nikki Haley bandwagon. Is that a crazy theory?
So a couple pieces. One, I think Grover is right about the kind of everybody loves a winner theory of things, but it assumes that the person who's president when you are 18 is viewed as a successful president.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you turned 18 when Ronald Reagan is in the White House and you and things seem to be going great, sure, maybe you'll become a Reaganite, and that'll be, I mean, it is true that political events that happen when you are, I believe from that Upshot study I mentioned earlier, they find if you are between, I think it's like 14 and 24, that those events have like three or four times the impact on your lifetime political views than something that happens when you're 40.
Andrew Roberts, the historian who just did that big book on Churchill, says that for leaders, it's actually when they're like 13 or 14.
Yeah.
And so like Margaret Thatcher, who I know you're a fan of, was listening to Winston Churchill give those great speeches when she was in her early teens. And like that it puts the indelible mark on your life.
Yeah, and that could be why I am still like a Jeb till I die. Because I grew up in Florida. And
right.
Like, you know, Jeb was the Republican governor of my state and was doing a good job.
Yeah.
So I am a case study in that. But I also think, like, let's assume that there had been a Republican governor who was not successful. The state hadn't been going well. The things were a disaster. That might not have worked out as well. And you do not see young people largely saying, I view Trump as a successful president. So that's where I think this may fall apart. It is true that things that happen when you are young have a dramatic impact on your political mm-hmm. ideology throughout the course of your life. But the mere fact of being president, I don't know if it's enough.
Oh, no, I agree.
And I think to the second point that you made, that things are evolving quickly, I think it is the case that Republicans, you know, let's say Donald Trump doesn't win in 2020. If everybody loves a winner, then the converse is, once you're a loser, everybody kind of wants you to go away and wants to turn the page. Look at what's happened to Hillary Clinton and the way the Democratic Party kind of treats her post-2016, right? She gives speeches and people say, oh, Hillary, you know, like,
yeah.
I mean, she has decades of experience in politics, and yet Democrats are kind of like, okay, Hillary, go away. And that's what happens when you lose. You know, there was a reason why it was not too long after the George W. Bush presidency ended that you kind of had the Tea Party saying, like, let's make a break with that and do something different. So I think if Trump loses or if his presidency ends and he is viewed by the Republican Party as, that was kind of unsuccessful. And I think if he loses in 2020, they'll get to that conclusion more quickly. Then absolutely there will be a, like, let's turn the page, let's find something new. But I don't think Republicans are there right now. I don't think they want to turn the page. I think Republican voters are, you know, in some ways pleasantly surprised by what they've gotten out of the Trump presidency.
I'm saying ride it out. Get as much good as we can out of this guy. But then the fear that we're going to be permanently branded the party of Trump, maybe it's a 5-year adjustment time, we reinvent ourselves, and it's Nikki Haley's party.
I think it requires strong leadership to change that. I think it will, because one, the Democratic Party will not want to let the Republican Party shake that, right? That, like, in a way that you know, I think that Democrats will be talking about Republicans as the party of Trump for a long time, repeatedly, over and over. I think Trump goes on people's permanent record, and I think
this will go down on your permanent
record. Yep, and I think that will be hard to shake. However, I am a very big believer in the power of strong individual leaders to change minds dramatically. I mean, love or hate Trump, he has dramatically reinvented the Republican Party in a very short period of time. So to say that no one else could do that, I mean, I think a lot of people...
You're saying this isn't compassionate conservatism?
A lot of people fancy themselves as, like, being able to pull off what Trump did, which I would tell you, if you have not had a reality show on network television for a decade and have not been in the public consciousness for decades on end and have flirted with running for president and written a million books and built
He's good at what he does.
Like, Trump is very unique.
Yeah.
Everyone out there who thinks they can just do what Trump did is fooling themselves. But I think that having a strong individual personality who's compelling and charismatic can move people to a new place, can rebrand a party. For sure, but there will be a lot of forces working against them.
So I wanted to ask you, I had an interesting conversation with a young friend of mine at a coffee shop this weekend, And I'd heard about this phenomenon before, but like I'm out of the scene. I'm older. I've been married for a while. I've got two kids. And I know you're married, but you study millennials. My friend was telling me about how there are girls in D.C. who, if they find out that he, like, is a conservative or a Republican, they literally won't date him. Mm-hmm. Or he might meet them at a bar, let's say, and what do? And once he finally tells them exactly what he does, they'll, like, walk away.
Yeah.
Or worse, throw a drink in his face or something. Like, this is this, like, an anomaly? Is this a trend? Is it just a D.C. thing? Like, I find it fascinating because it's different than when I was, like, in my teenage or 20s.
Yeah. So when you were in high school, what were, like, the big cliques in your school? Like, what were the big groups? I mean, we had, like, there were, you know, the lacrosse players and the cheerleaders, and you had, like, the drama and choir kids.
Yeah.
And the band kids, and you had the debate kids. I mean, like, there were, it's the opening scene of, the cafeteria scene in Mean Girls, right?
Yeah.
When she's walking through and, like, there's the art kids.
There's no scenario where somebody says, I can't hang out with him because he voted for Dukakis. Or
right, there's not like, where. So I wrote this column at the Washington Examiner a week ago. There was a piece in Esquire that got a lot of controversy. It was, they're doing profiles of different Americans, and they did a profile of a 17-year-old, somewhat conservative, white male living in, I think, around Green Bay, Wisconsin. And, or somewhere in Wisconsin. And he talks about how at his high school, they have, like, there are cliques based on your political ideology and where you stand. I mean, so you are taking the hyper-partisanship of D.C., and it has now been injected into the already kind of toxic cauldron of high school cliquishness. And that seems corrosive.
That's horrible.
And scary.
Yeah.
And I say this as someone who, when I was in high school, you know, was watching the presidential election with great interest and joined the debate team and was kind of bummed that, you know, no one else in my high school knew or cared who Neil Cavuto was. And, like, now it's almost like the pendulum has swung too far the other way, where, you know, maybe when I was growing up, kids weren't interested in politics at all. Now their identities are being defined by their politics. And that is, I think that's just troublesome. Now, to the reason why someone, like, let's say someone in their 20s, we're past the cliquishness phase, we're in our 20s, why would someone not date someone of the other party? We have really gone from, and politics has always been about values. It's not always just been like, oh, you think the top marginal tax rate should be 60, and I think it should be 20. Let's 40. Hey, everybody wins.
You know, right.
That's a romanticized view of the way political discourse has gone. But there, I think, really has become a heightened sense that people don't just disagree about the way to achieve similar goals, but that people have very different visions of what America ought to be, and that those are incompatible. And if you hold a different vision of what America ought to be, there is something morally wrong with you.
Yeah.
And therefore, it's not just you like a band I don't like. It's you have values I don't like. And that's, look, our politics are rooted in our values. I think now it has become that our politics are defining our consumer identity. What type of razor will I buy? Well, gosh, this one razor company ran an ad about toxic masculinity. Do I think that's good or bad? Do I buy this athletic apparel? They stood with Colin Kaepernick. Do I stand with Colin Kaepernick or not? That even our consumer choices are now rooted in some way, shape, or form in kind of our stance on hot-button political issues. And I don't see that trend abating unless America just finally goes, we are exhausted. And this is where, to only briefly circle back to the, like, Klobuchar 2020 momentum, does America finally decide, I don't want politics in every moment of my life. I don't want to be thinking about this constantly. I would like to go back to a sense of normalcy where I'm not feeling like politics is woven into my friendships, into my shopping, into everything I do. I want politics to be boring again. We may get to a backlash point, but for Gen Z, I mean, the world they're growing up in is one where your political values are front and center as a piece of your identity. And your identity is wrapped up. I mean, again, gender, race, et cetera, these are all that is identity politics, right? That your identity and your politics are deeply intertwined, and therefore, in the same way that you wake up in the morning and you are your gender and your race and your age, and those are things that are the lens through which you see the world, for young people coming to politics at a younger age, thinking about these things, forming cliques about it, it is the lens through which they are seeing the world even earlier on.
So depressing. Since you mentioned bands and high school, I want to ask a little bit about you, like how you got here. You mentioned Florida, being from Florida. So talk about how you ended up here, and I want to hear about your band too.
Oh, sure.
Because I used to play in bands. We'll talk.
Oh, sure. So when I was in high school, I had started off where I was, you know, drama, choir, in the school musical, like the music was my passion. But I was also the kid that was always like running for student government president, unsuccessfully in middle school, more successfully in high school. Learned a lot of lessons from that process that have informed the way I think about actual federal politics now. But when I was in high school, got on the, you know, joined the debate team, because I cared about politics. I had a history teacher that sort of nudged me that direction. And the rest is history. Like, I watched The West Wing. I got Sorkinized. And, you know, here we are. You know, went to the University of Florida, but really had the D.C. bug. Came to Washington to intern in 2005. And it was right after George W. Bush had been reelected. It turns out that's kind of a terrible time to come and intern in Washington, because there's nothing campaign-y going on. The cycle has ended. So I interned at the NRCC in an almost empty building, because the campaign committees, when it's not campaign season, tend to kind of clear out. Learned about the world of campaign fundraising. Realized I never wanted to run for office. Like, it made running for office seem so unappealing. But learned about that world. Really realized that I had an aptitude for data and investigation and wanting to understand not just what's a compelling message, because my gut tells me something's a compelling message, but what's a compelling message? Where do people stand? What do they think? Based on actual research, going and talking to them, kind of being a pollster in a way is like being America's press secretary, because you are going out and you're finding out what do they believe, and then you are trying to convey that back to the politicians and thought leaders who need to be listening to them, but otherwise their frame of reference is who yells the loudest at a town hall or who calls their office the most.
Right, which is not scientific.
Right.
Maybe there's
it's valuable.
It tells you intensity,
I want people
but
to
not,
call Congress yeah. their congressman's office. I want people to go to their congresswoman's town hall. Like, I do those things. But there are a lot of voters who that's not how they're engaging in politics. But their views still matter, too. And so can I, as a pollster, surface and elevate those points of view? I think that's an important function of what I do. So started off at a polling firm in 2006, then, you know, graduated, moved back to Washington, and stayed with that firm for 8 years, kind of learning the trade, going to grad school at night. That's where I wrote that thesis about younger voters that's now 10 years old. And from there, turned it into a book, The Selfie Vote, and then went off on my own, started my own polling shop, and really tried to begin focusing, one, on how can we do polling in an interesting new way? How can we focus on emerging key audiences like millennials, you know, really carving out a niche as the firm that gets these emerging trends first? And then trying to get more into the media world, sort of realizing, look, I can do good work for my clients, but I also want to make sure that I'm helping to inject something interesting into the national discussion. If I can surface some kind of new insight that no one's thought of before that can help us understand the world a little better, I want to be a part of that too. And so that's sort of how I have this career that is both the private work I do for clients through Echelon and then writing a book, writing columns, going on TV.
Do you still play in a band?
No. So the band was sort of my like after work hobby. It was in 2007 and I had been singing karaoke, I guess somewhat successfully, at a birthday party, and was approached by the college buddies of my now husband. He and I were just, we were not dating at the time. And they said, hey, have you ever wanted to be in a band? And I said, oh, I wanted to be Gwen Stefani, like when I was growing up. Monique Powell from Save Ferris, like this, I wanted to be them. And they were like, great, because we have a ska band and we're looking for a singer. And it was like, oh my gosh.
Awesome.
I mean, it wasn't the 90s anymore, right? To find people that have a ska band was like, whew. Woohoo! This is exciting.
I'm looking to start an alt country band called Buckley's Angel, if you're interested.
Do you need a singer?
Because I can't sing that one.
I don't have many. I mean, I used to play piano. We attempted having me play keys on a few songs. It was unsuccessful. I have an electric guitar that I tried to teach myself how to play once, but have since sort of lost that. I don't have the calluses anymore. But music was, you know, before I became a debate kid, I was in the musicals. Like that's kind of was the first love before politics, and I miss it. And the other thing that I think was good about it is politics is this very buttoned up, you know, very staid, very small C conservative kind of world.
Yeah, I mean, D.C. is a conservative town, in the way we dress.
D.C. is a small C conservative town, and the music world is not. The music world, you know, I would go on stage, and I was always wearing, like, red dresses. And at first, they were, like, kind of conservative red. But, like, for me, wearing a red dress was like, ooh, that's so, like, wow. But then, like, you look at someone like a Lady Gaga, right? And she's just...
She wears a meat jacket.
She wears jackets made out of meat. Yeah. I mean, I'm not advocating that if you run for president, you ought to be wearing jackets made out of meat. But I think there is something to be said for... I mean, watch it... The millennials may never have done this, but, like, watch videos of Elvis. Like, just watch him perform. I mean, go find footage of the best musical entertainers of the past couple of decades. And they're all... uninhibited, and they're dressed unusually, and they're, and I think that, you know, being in a band and sort of trying to evolve a little bit. I mean, I was never Lady Gaga level interesting. I was so conservative and boring by almost any metric, but just sort of learned through that experience that, like, there is something to being unique and interesting and taking risks and being out there, even if it's something that in your own mind you're like, oh, that's kind of weird. Like, there's a reason why people follow those entertainers and celebrities, and the people who are just kind of boring can get forgotten. And being a pollster, I come from a small C conservative, fairly boring industry. So again, you're not going to see me, like, on television in a meat dress anytime soon. But it did sort of inform my thinking about persuasion and how to build. How to build a following, and why visuals and being unique and interesting really, really matters there.
Oh yeah, so, like, it's funny because, like, I once I started doing this, I initially thought all my time playing in bands was, like, first of all, my parents were probably, like, really afraid I was going to just totally be a loser, like, living in their basement.
Oh, no.
But then I started thinking about a lot of what I do today. I actually learned from playing in a band. So, like, a lot of it was about promoting the band, because it's not really about just being good. Like, you could be a great or really tight band, but you have to get people to come.
It's more political than politics.
Yeah.
It is 100%.
You have to build a fan base and turn them out to hear you play or to buy CDs.
You have to build a fan base. It's just like you have to, if you're a politician, you have to build your voter base. If you're a band, you have to build your fan base. Where do you target them? How do you find them? How do you introduce them to the music that you have? But then the other piece of it is, you know, you're not going to be able to just snap your fingers and you're opening at 9:30 Club, right?
Yeah.
You've got to be the third act on someone's, on someone's night.
So you're playing at the Galaxy Hut.
You're playing
the Velvet Lounge.
Yeah, like a much smaller venue, and you're third on the bill. And so, how do you network with the band that's second or first and get them to go, like, hey, oh, we've got this other band that'll open for us? I mean, that kind of, like, bands coming to watch us and then afterwards being like, hey, if you guys ever need an opening act, let us know. And then us doing that to other bands.
Building relationships.
Building those relationships. That, I found that world to be more political than working in actual politics.
It is. And good luck getting paid at the end of the night. Even if they've told you they're going to pay. The other thing is performing. So being able to get up on stage and perform in front of an audience, I use now. Well, we're using it right now.
Yeah.
And the trick for me was I never focused on perfection, so I adopted this kind of jazz improvisational ethos, which said, like, the bad notes are good. And so if I tried to be perfect, I would have been too nervous to do it. But I was like, no, it's not about being perfect. It's about being real, being authentic. So, like, a lot of these little things that I learned from being a failed artist, I use the term very loosely, from being a failed musician, have really come in handy for what I do now. And it makes me think, you know, not to get too deep, but about, like, when you look back and you know, I don't know if there's, like, a grand plan or what, but that how things that you did that maybe they didn't work out, maybe it's relationships or whatever, but they help you become the person that you ultimately want to be. So that's cool. This would be a great place to end it, but I'm not going to end it there because I have one more big thing I want to talk to you about, which is kind of the efficacy of polling. I think there are a lot of people who just don't believe the polls, and maybe that's because of the fake news media. Maybe that's because people aren't answering landlines now. They're answering cell phones. Maybe it's because people are lying to pollsters intentionally. But for whatever reason, I think the polling industry took a hit in terms of its credibility. Where are we on that? And can I now, should I believe the polls when they tell me what Trump's approval rating is or whatever?
So the polls are something you should consume carefully. They are not fake news. Media organizations are not making up numbers to push a narrative. And I think a great example of this is Fox News's polling operation. I am constantly defending them to my progressive friends because Fox News, the way they conduct their polls, their polling outfit, has no ideology. They tend to find President Trump's job approval about the same place that CNN's poll does. I mean, and so these media outlets, even if you perceive that the media itself is biased, by and large, their polling outfits want to get it right. Think about incentives. If you are a conservative, you believe markets work. People in a free market have an incentive to want to get things right. Because if you are a pollster and you are out there with a bunch of numbers that are wrong, theoretically, the market's going to punish you. If you're the one pollster that nails it, that gets it right, the market will reward you. You will get promoted. Your numbers will be more trusted. So pollsters don't want to get it wrong. Everybody's competing to try to get it right. And in fact, there's a phenomenon in the polling world called herding, where if five pollsters have all released a number that says President Trump's job approval is between 40 and 42%, and you are the sixth pollster and your poll shows that his job approval is at 30%, this phenomenon is where that sixth pollster might just like sit on their numbers and not release them because mm-hmm. they're worried, did I make a mistake? Did I do something wrong? That pollsters are really averse. They don't want to be wrong.
But isn't that also a problem? Because maybe the
30% is bad. Herding is very bad.
There's this thing in football where, statistically speaking, you should almost always go for it on fourth down. Right? But coaches almost always punt on fourth down. Yeah. And that's because their incentive is actually not to win. It's to not.
Aversion.
Right.
Yeah.
It's loss aversion.
And so, for sure. And so, herding is a thing that happens in the polling world that is bad. Herding is part of why I think the polls missed one of the British elections recently and what have you. But the reason why I bring it up is to sort of say, okay, first understand the mindset of someone working as a pollster in a media organization. They want to get it right. They don't want to be the one that's out there or that's off. They want to be. They just want to be accurate. But doing polling nowadays, as you mentioned, is really hard. People don't answer landline phones anymore, except sort of older Americans tend to be easiest to reach there. Folks in rural areas tend to be easiest to reach there. But for young people who live in cities, it's cell phones. And when was the last time you picked up a cell phone call from a number you didn't recognize? I mean, caller ID in the 90s sort of began the demise of people picking up the phone when they didn't know who was calling. And so now you have online polling that's gotten more sophisticated but isn't perfect yet, and it's almost impossible to use online polling to do something like poll in a congressional district. So its uses are kind of limited to, you know, certain statewide things in politics, national trends. However, the other thing I would add is that the polls in 2016 were less bad than advertised. So the national polls said that Hillary Clinton was likely to win the national popular vote by about 3 points. And in the end, she won the national popular vote by about 2 points. That just happens to not be how we elect presidents in this country. So the national polls were not that wrong. In fact, they were more accurate in 2016 than they were in 2012 when they showed Mitt Romney, you know, Gallup had, I think, Romney 49, Obama 48, and, you know, Obama won pretty comfortably that year. The polls nationally in 2016 were kind of okay. It was the polls in certain blue wall states that were really wrong. Your Michigan polls, your Wisconsin, your Pennsylvania, oh my gosh, Pennsylvania. I mean, there were a lot of these states where the polling was off, and it was just the right set of states that your model would project just the right proportion.
Perfect storm.
Yeah, it was a perfect storm. And the good news is the polling industry, wanting to get it right because market incentives suggest if you're wrong all the time, no one's going to hire you. They did a deep dive and figured out that the reason why those polls were so off is the polls were not getting enough voters without college degrees. So typically, pollsters will weight their data based on known demographic characteristics. If I call 1,000 registered voters and 550 of them are women, that's probably too many women. That's not really the right proportion of what's going to show up at the polls. We know election after election after election, it tends to be closer to 47-53, 48-52. So I will wait to meet what the expected, what the census tells me, you know, what credible data sources say, this is what it's supposed to look like. You do the same thing on race, you do the same thing on age. You can know from census data and other credible large data sources what it should look like. Education used to not be a, oh, and also, by the way, those three factors play a big role in who you vote for, right? They, you know, there are gender divides, there are age divides, there are race divides. And so if you mess up that in your sample, you're going to mess up the result. Education didn't used to be that way in a big way. If you had too many people with college degrees, there wasn't as strong a correlation between your level of education and who you were voting for. That correlation became quite strong in the 2016 election. But not all polls were weighting their data to make sure that they had the right mix of education. So we now know, looking back, hindsight is 2020, if you go back and you take those polls and you actually weight them for education, you kind of fix the problem. But it's the thing you can know looking back.
Yeah.
They didn't know looking forward. So I think the question for pollsters this time around is, A, are you making sure to get a good mix of your landline, your cell phone, online? Are you doing some kind of hybrid methodology where you're really able to reach everyone? B, are you doing research that is based on a list of people you know to be voters? Right now, a lot of research is sometimes done through random digit dialing. They'll just randomly call a bunch of numbers. But we have a lot of information in the US about who voters are, what their behavior is, how they're registered. And so use that information to make sure you're not missing pockets of voters. If I'm calling into a state and all of the people that are registered Republican are not picking up the phone, then maybe I do have a silent Trump voter problem. Maybe I do need to figure this out. Whereas if I know that Republicans are just as likely to take my survey as Democrats, I can rest a little easier. So those are things you can
That's
know for sure.
Really helpful. This has been a great conversation. How can people who want to buy your book, listen to your podcast, follow you on Twitter, or read your columns, how can they do that?
Oh, a couple different things. Follow me on Twitter, at @ksoltisanderson, or on Instagram. Instagram's more fun, less political.
Yes.
But I can promise both places lots of pictures of my dog, Wally. He's a golden retriever. He's old. He's wonderful. He's better than any political tweet you will see from me. You can also, I have a show on Sirius XM, airs Saturdays at 10 a.m. on POTUS Channel 124. It's called The Trend Line. And my podcast, The Pollsters, you can find us on Twitter at The Pollsters, and we're on iTunes, Stitcher, Spotify, the various places where podcasts are sold. So you can find me there. And I write a column for The Washington Examiner every other week.
Awesome. It's been great. Kristen Soltis-Anderson, thank you for coming on the news.
Thanks for having me.